Good morning to all of you. We welcome you to this first of our Payton lectures for this year. I'm Richard Mouw, the president of Fuller Seminary. In my roadshow speech about Fuller, I talk about our founding in 1947 by a group of founders who were deeply concerned about three defects in the world of evangelicalism of the day, that post-World War II movement that at the time was terminologically indistinguishable from fundamentalism. They were concerned about anti-intellectualism, they were concerned about an otherworldly ethic, and they were concerned about a very strong separatistic spirit. And it was 2 years after the founding of Fuller in 1947, in the year 1949, that Fuller established the Payton Lectures in the honor of Dr. John E. Payton, who was the father of Mrs. Charles E. Fuller. And it's pretty hard to find a list of all the Payton Lectures. I tried this morning. There's nothing to be found on the Fuller website anymore. I did find a guy, for some reason, some guy on his blog lists all the lecturers since 1961. But I know in my own case, as a budding intellectual in college, I read Gordon Clark's book, very popular among evangelicals at the time, called The Christian View of Men and Things, really human beings and things, Christian View of Men and Things, which was the 1951 Payton Lectures. And so early on, I was very much influenced by the results of the establishing of that Payton Lectureship. But we're just delighted that each year we can have folks come in from the broader Christian community and enlighten us on issues that we need to be thinking about and wrestling with here at Fuller Seminary. And I'm personally delighted about the choice of this year's Payton lecturer, about whom you will hear more from our Dean, Howard Loewen, after I open in prayer. Let's pray together. And Holy God, we come to you on this day that you have made, acknowledging that you are indeed the Lord of our minds. And we pray that in this time together, as we think about important issues in biblical and more specifically New Testament thought, that your Spirit will be with us in a special way, guiding us into more truth. We pray for our speaker. We thank you for the wonderful contribution that he has made thus far to the world of Christian scholarship, and we look forward to the ways in which he will add to that contribution today. So bless us now, and I pray these things in the strong name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As Dean of the School of Theology, it is my pleasure also to welcome all of you to this special lectureship, the Payton Lectures of 2010. And as our president has indicated, the historical roots and origins of these lectures are important, even though they might be a little cloudy in terms of some of the details. But the intent of these lectures really is to provide opportunity for this community to hear the best biblical and theological scholarship from around the nation and the world. That was the intent of the Paytons when these lectureships were established. And so today, it is my privilege on behalf of the School of Theology to welcome and introduce another guest of honor who joins this class of distinguished Payton Lectures. And it is a class of distinguished Payton Lectures. Dr. Luke Timothy Johnson, the Robert W. Woodruff Professor of New Testament and Christian Origins at the Candor School of Theology. And Dr. Johnson, it's a special treat to have you here and a special welcome from all of us to you. Dr. Johnson completed his PhD in New Testament Studies at Yale University, teaching at Yale Divinity School for 6 years after that, and then at Indiana University, before moving on to his present position at Emory in 1992. Dr. Johnson's scholarship, his teaching, his research and writing focuses on a broad range of areas, including, as you will note, commentaries on James, the pastorals, and especially Luke Acts also. I think there's something prescient about our distinguished lecturer being named Luke well before anyone knew he'd become a leading scholar in this field. So note that connection. Dr. Johnson performs his biblical and theological scholarship with a strong ecclesial consciousness. He was for a considerable period of time a Benedictine monk and priest before becoming a biblical scholar. And he remains a layperson in the Roman Catholic community. So he comes to us with a background and experience that eminently qualifies him to speak on the chosen theme of this year's Payton Lecture, Spirit and Body, the Corinthians and the New Creation. And the first lecture you will hear this morning is entitled Life-Giving Spirit, the Ontological Implications of the Resurrection. Then tomorrow, in our second lecture, the title is The Body in Question, the Complexities of Somatic Existence. And each lecture, as you shall note, will be immediately followed by a respondent, a faculty respondent, faculty member from the School of Theology, I might add, followed by a Q&A period of time. And I also want to remind you that following each of the Q&As, there will be a book signing out in the lobby. You'll notice a table full of books there, so take advantage of that. Many of Dr. Johnson's books are out there to peruse, and particularly also to purchase and have signed by the author himself. There will be a short 3-minute break after Dr. Johnson's lecture. For those of you who need to go to class or work, you can depart, and then we will reconvene with the faculty response. Today will be Dr. David Downs, our own assistant professor of New Testaments in the School of Theology, and tomorrow it'll be Dr. Joel Green, also from our New Testament Theology department. So now please join me in welcoming our special guest, Dr. Luke Timothy Johnson.
Thank you, Howard. Good morning. It's a delight for me to be here. I'm honored to be in that distinguished line of Payton lecturers. I would recommend that anybody who has a New Testament with them to open it up. We're going to be looking especially at Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. The resurrection is undoubtedly the foundation for all Christian confession and practice. The statement, Jesus is Lord, definitively distinguished the first believers from other Jews and continues to demarcate Christians from all other religions. This confession, Jesus is Lord, has three essential parts. It first states something about Jesus, a historical Jewish man of the first century who was executed under Roman authority. Second, the implied verb is makes a declaration about a present situation rather than a past event. The confession concerns the status of Jesus now. Third, it declares that the one who was crucified, a historical fact, is now Lord. That is, fully participant in divine life and rule. The term Kyrios, Lord, bears with it the full weight of the divine name, since the Septuagint used that very term, Kyrios, to render the Tetragrammaton. Now, two further observations on this simple but all-important confession. It is what linguists would call a performative utterance. That is, it does not merely state a fact that is potentially observable to all, but declares a personal commitment to a reality that perhaps others cannot perceive. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 8:6, although there are many so-called gods and lords in the world, for us, says Paul, there is but one Lord, Jesus Christ. Paul insists that no one can make that performative utterance, Jesus is Lord, except in or through the Holy Spirit, en to pneumati hagio. The meaning of the term kyrios, moreover, is clarified by the frequent use of Psalm 110:1 with reference to Jesus' resurrection. The Lord, kyrios, said to my Lord, kyriomu, sit at my right hand until I place your enemies beneath your feet. The lordship of Jesus, that is to say the resurrection of Jesus, is understood as royal exaltation. Jesus enters fully into the life and the rule of God. The confession of Jesus as Lord is the resurrection confession, and it involves or implicates both Jesus and the one who confesses. That's the starting point. That's the good news from God. Such good news, however, is both amazing and confusing, that a singular human being, to say nothing of an executed criminal, should after his death enter into the life and power of God. Small wonder, then, that almost from the start, Christians themselves have struggled to grasp the truth of this good news in the fullness of its truth, and have tended to slip away from the full paradox of the resurrection faith in a variety of ways. Some have diminished the confession's power by making it exclusively about the believer. Jesus lives on in some spiritual fashion in the lives of his followers through the memory of his teaching or the imitation of his acts or the continuation of his prophetic program or even through a form of self-knowledge that constitutes an elevation of the individual psyche. Now, all of these post-mortem memories of Jesus are actually attested in the earliest Christian writings, but they are never identified with the resurrection. Others, upset because the subjective interpretation seems much too, well, subjective, seek to secure the objective character of the resurrection by insisting that it is, in one way or another, a historical event concerning the historical Jesus. Jesus was not killed, somebody else was, or Jesus got really, really sick and then got better. More often, Jesus really died, but then, as in contemporary experiences of clinical death, was then resuscitated, proof of which was found in the empty tomb and Easter appearances. Making the resurrection historical, however, that is, making it an event in time and space that can be empirically verified, falls short, alas, of the confession that Jesus is Lord. In resuscitation, after all, mortality is not transcended. It is merely deferred. It means simply continuing on in the same plane of empirical human existence, rather than sharing fully in God's rule over the universe. Christians today flounder in their grasp of the central truth of their existence. The resurrection, rather than being the ground and power of every act of Christian preaching, becomes an event of the past that is preached on once a year as part of the liturgical cycle. Rather than a celebration of the greatest display of God's power to bring into being that which is not, which enables us gladly to use the language of myth and of mystery, the resurrection is an embarrassment that must be defended or explained away before Christianity's cultured despisers, using the very epistemological instruments drawn from the Enlightenment that make serious interpretation of the resurrection impossible. A key element in the present diminished appreciation for the resurrection among Christians, to the extent that some seriously consider a reconstruction of a historical Jesus to be an adequate norm for Christian identity, a key element is the lack of appropriate language. How can we speak of Holy Spirit when we lack a phenomenology of any spirit? In a world that rejects the notion of soul, and in which intellectuals eschew talk even of the mind, preferring to analyze brain chemistry, how can we speak of spirit in any meaningful way? How can we speak of a spiritual body when we have not thought about the meaning of any form of embodied existence, when our default image of body is derived from Descartes? The same conceptual linguistic flattening, indeed, affects our very reading of the New Testament witness concerning the resurrection, so that even when the text is plainly speaking about something more than a resuscitation, we insist on thinking it is speaking of something historical. In this lecture and in the next, I propose to engage the very difficult texts in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, the first extended and explicit discussion of the resurrection we have, dating from about 25 years after Jesus' crucifixion. And I want to show how Paul's language demands of us an ability to think and to speak in ontological rather than historical terms. I'll try to make that contrast clearer as we go along. I begin with 1 Corinthians 15, and you can go there first, but then move into the rest of the letter, because although it comes at the end of the composition, Paul's statements concerning the resurrection in chapter 15 are, like the truth of that confession itself, the ground for everything he has said previously to the Corinthians. Now, I do apologize for committing exegesis in your presence. And I know that taking a serious look at specific texts is not nearly so flashy as making grand statements about all kinds of things. But I do think that we have to begin with the text in this case in order to refresh ourselves with regard to what Paul really is trying to say. So what I would like to do, for those of you who have your Bibles, and if you don't, shame on you. No, I'm teasing. And tomorrow you will bring them, if indeed you return. So I want to begin with Paul's argument in 1 Corinthians 15. The first 11 verses of Paul's discussion are a robust reminder to the Corinthians of both dimensions of the resurrection confession that I began with. First, as it concerns them, this is the good news of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection is among the first things, or things of first importance, entois protois, that Paul proclaimed to them. This good news was accepted by them, and they stand in it, and they are now being saved by it. If, he says, indeed, they remain in it. Second, as concerns Jesus. His death and resurrection on the third day were attested by the scriptures. He was seen as resurrected by many witnesses, some of whom are still alive. He was seen by Paul himself, a statement that Paul iterates earlier in 1 Corinthians 9:1. Have I not seen the Lord Jesus? And on the basis of this gift, Paul says, he has expended all of his efforts. And Paul concludes in 5:11 by drawing those two dimensions together when he declares, whether it was I or they, that is, the other witnesses or him, so we preach and so you believe. The death and burial and resurrection of Jesus are the bedrock of the shared apostolic proclamation and of shared Christian identity, what Paul calls earlier in his letter, fellowship with God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, 1 Corinthians 1:9. Paul next reasserts the centrality of the resurrection against the claim apparently made by some among his readers that, quote, there is no resurrection of the dead, end quote. We're not sure who made that declaration or even what precisely they meant by it. If we follow Paul's logic in the subsequent argument, we're probably on fairly safe ground in concluding that the position these people took had to do above all with their own future. They saw no need of a resurrection of the body because they were so impressed by the already of God's rule that they enjoyed, enriched as they were, and as Paul acknowledges, with every kind of knowledge and speech. If Paul's mockery of them in chapter 4 following is to be read in this connection, then they saw themselves already in their present empirical bodily condition as already ruling, that is, already fully entered into God's kingdom and exercising authority within it. Paul's response to this position, there is no resurrection of the dead, is built on three conditional sentences in 15:13, 15:16, and 15:18. And the first two are identical. If the dead are not raised, then neither is Christ raised. And each of these two is followed by another conditional, but if Christ is not raised. And in each case, this protasis is followed by three distinct apodices dealing not with Christ, but with them. In 15:14, if Christ is not raised, the set of consequences is the emptiness of the proclamation, the emptiness of their faith, and the preachers as false witnesses against God. In 15:17, the three apostasies is the foolishness of their faith, the continuation of their condition of being in sin, and the loss of those who have already died in Christ. The point of stressing the resurrection of Christ as the test case of the truth of the resurrection, in short, is that without his resurrection, quote, the good news they received in which they stand and by which they are being saved is utter fantasy. The resurrection is not simply about Jesus, but about them, their present way of being in the world. So Paul's last conditional, if we have hoped in Christ for this life only, then we are the most pitiable of humans, 15:19. And all those who preach as he does, the resurrection is not about Jesus alone. It is not simply an event of the past. It is a reality that at once determines their present reality and shapes their future hope. You doing okay? All right. As long as there is sentient life here, that's all I'm asking. Now, having secured that link between Christ's resurrection and their present condition, Paul turns to that future hope intimated in 15:19. Their future is to go where Christ already has gone. He is the aparche, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. He is paradigmatic for humanity's being given life as the first human was paradigmatic for humanity's living under death. In Christ, he says, all will be brought to life. Panta zo'o poethesantai. We will all be given this life. And we will see that same verse, zo'o poyun, critically in chapter 15, verse 45. But when he says that each one will be brought to life in his own rank, Paul reminds those thinking that they already have the fullness of the resurrection that they are wrong. Indeed, not even the exalted Lord has yet reached the telos of God's plan. Christ's dominion has yet to conquer all inimical powers and authorities, or even the ultimate enemy of death. When all that has been accomplished, then Christ will hand over rule to God, who will be at the last panta en passin, all things in all things. 15:23-28. Now, in his discussion, up to this point, Paul's language has shifted from the historical, properly historical, what was preached to them, Jesus' death and appearances, and the experiential, those who witnessed him, the present faith and salvation of the believers, but then shifts to the mythological, the parousia of Christ, his enthronement, his triumph over all cosmic enemies, his handing over the kingdom to God. How could such language not be mythological? The matters of which Paul speaks are not on the present empirical plane of Paul and the Corinthians, but on a future cosmic plane where the exalted Christ, spiritual powers, and God are the contenders. When Paul concludes with the statement, however, so that God might be all things in all things, his language becomes unavoidably ontological. He makes a statement about the cause of all that exists with respect to everything that is existent. He is making a statement, that is, about being itself. God being all that is with or within all that is, panta en passin. The resurrection, exaltation of Jesus as Lord, it appears, has implications that are unmistakably ontological. The resurrection, to put a really quick point on it, doesn't change the furniture of the world. It changes the very structures of human existence. It is at this juncture that Paul responds to a question posed by his imagined interlocutor. How will the dead be raised? With what sort of body do they come? His first response is a dismissive, "You fool." The question appears foolish on two counts. First, it seems to assume that the dead who will be raised will have empirical bodies like you and I do, or like the presently alive Corinthians, and perhaps this is for some of them, as for many present-day skeptics, a major stumbling block to a wholehearted acceptance of future resurrection. Sounds like the night of the living dead, for one thing, and also there's not really that much room for that many empirical bodies. A simple coming back to empirical life is not good news for the earth or the ones who are awakened. The question also seems foolish because how could Paul or any human being know the answer, since neither Paul nor any other human had risen from the dead? But wait, perhaps there is a way of getting at the question that will also get at the arrogant position of Paul's readers. Paul can argue about the future resurrection of all on analogy from the resurrection of Jesus, since he's already intrinsically and intentionally linked the two. Jesus' resurrection and their resurrection is linked. Now, what does not work analogously is the status of Christ as Lord, or his exaltation to God's right hand. But on the question of what kind of body, again, notice an inescapably ontological query of what sort of body, being, Paul can draw some analogies. He prepares them for his central analogy by drawing them into some observations on the natural world as they understand it. Seeds that are sown must die before they come back to life, and when they do, God gives the bare seed that was sown a body as God wills. This is 15:36-38. He reminds them of the different kinds of flesh, sarx, to be observed in humans as distinct from birds and beasts and fish, and that there really are qualitative differences between the bodies, somata, that we observe on earth and the ones that we observe in the heavens. And here Paul introduces the term glory or radiance, doxa, to distinguish the heavenly bodies, the sun, the moon, the stars, from the earthly. Indeed, he says, stars differ from stars in their radiance or glory, their doxa, in 1541. The effect of these comparisons is to emphasize two points. First, there is some continuity between what is sown and what is raised, and there is real discontinuity between what is sown and what is raised. The second is that God can surprise with new bodies. And God's range of inventiveness with respect to bodies is displayed not only on the earthly level, the diverse meanings of flesh when applied to humans and animals and so forth, but on the heavenly level where radiance and glory define the meaning of body. So he's expanding our notion of body in this fashion, pushing our imaginations beyond our lumpish selves to a somewhat wider embrace of God's creative imagination. Then with the transition, thus also it is with the resurrection of the dead in 1542, Paul turns to his main analogy between the resurrection of Christ and the future condition of the resurrected dead. He begins with three dramatic contrasts that not only echo earlier comparisons in his letter, but also language for those comparisons he makes earlier in the letter. The body is sown in corruption, but it is raised in incorruptibility. It is sown in dishonor, but it is raised in glory or radiance. It is sown in weakness and raised in strength. These three sets anticipate the fourth, for Paul's language clearly points to the contrast between the merely material, which is always corruptible, weak, and liable to shame, and the more than merely material, a body that shares in incorruption, a glory, and strength. The fourth contrast that these have set up is between the psychikos and the pneumatikos. Both terms are more obscure, you're willing to grant, than, since I haven't translated them, the psychikos and pneumatikos are more obscure than the ones that preceded them. But if we allow Paul to be consistent in his contrast, then we must align psychikos with what I have called the merely material, or the empirical. That is, what is always corruptible, subject to dishonor, and weak. By the same logic, we assign pneumatikos with the strength, incorruptibility, and radiance of the more than merely material, or the super empirical. Paul insists on the seriousness of this last contrast, the most important one, by adding, if there is a psychikos soma, there is also a pneumatikos soma. Okay, so if there is a merely material body, weak, corruptible, subject to shame, there is, he insists, a pneumatikos soma, a body that is more than empirical, that is strong, that is incorruptible, that is immortal, that is filled with glory. Now, all of these disjunctions contrast the kinds of flesh or bodies with which the Corinthians are familiar. This is us, bodies that are fleshly, corruptible, liable to dishonor and weakness, with bodies with which they are unfamiliar. Unless they think of those far-off bodies of the sun, moon, and stars, and think of them as radiant and corruptible and strong, because they partake of pneuma. And the word pneuma, of course, is spirit. By using the term soma pneumatikos, spiritual body, Paul pushes the Corinthians and us beyond the range of the empirical and the verifiable to the realm of the ontological and non-verifiable. A spiritual body is for us, at the very least, oxymoronic. The two terms simply do not seem to go together. That's the point! Paul's next statements make clear that he is speaking of a spiritual body and that this is not language that he has just stumbled into. Rather, this is where his entire argument has been heading, as he shows immediately by supporting it from a scriptural citation from Genesis 2:7 in the Septuagint, a citation that he reads retrospectively from the perspective of the resurrection. If that's for me, tell him I'm busy. I'm talking about the resurrection, is what... Paul reads that Genesis citation retrospectively from the perspective of Jesus' resurrection. The text of Genesis has, "The Lord God formed man out of the clay of ground and blew into his nostrils the breath of life, and so man became a living being." But Paul quotes only the last line, "Eis psychein zoson." We see again the term psychic, here referring to ordinary human existence. But Paul has that phrase characterize ho protos Adam, the first Adam, in order to set up a typology that he also uses in Romans 5:12 to 21, between the first and the new creation. The first Adam became a living being because God's breath animated the clay from which he was formed. But Paul contrasts that first human paradigm for us all with the one he calls the eschatos Adam, the eschatological Adam, the last Adam, who became, and this is the key, who became eis pneuma zoiopoion. He became life-giving spirit. 1545. Mark it. The phrase is important not only because it opposes psychikos and pneuma, but because the adjective zoiopoion, life-giving, is applied by Scripture only to the living God. The contrast between Adam and Christ, then, is between natural life and resurrection life. The meaning of the resurrection of Jesus is not that he came back to life, but he became life-giving. Giving spirit, that is, entered completely into the life and power of God and the source of life to others as God is. In the case of Christ, resurrection means exaltation into the presence and power of God, since God alone is the giver of life. Paul drives home his point in 1546 to 48. The pneuma was not first with respect to humans, but the psyche. The first human was drawn from clay. The second human, Christ, was from heaven. And as before, he makes the connection between the paradigmatic human and those in his image. As with the earthly one, so with those who are earthly. As with the heavenly one, so with those who are heavenly. If humans have borne the image of the one made from clay, so do they, we, bear the image also of the one from heaven. Once more. Although the followers of Christ have not reached the state of being life-giving like the exalted Lord Jesus, they do participate somehow in his image. And Paul suggests that the medium of that participation, both for the future and the present, has to do with pneuma, spirit. Paul closes his argument in chapter 15, not with exposition, but with exhortation. He turns to the behavioral correlates of standing in the good news of Christ's resurrection. The message is simple. They must change. Full participation, when he says, we shall not all fall asleep, but we all must be changed. You have to change. Full participation in God's rule is not available to flesh and blood. That is, to merely ordinary human existence, much less an existence defined precisely by flesh. The corruptible, that is, the mortal, cannot without change inherit immortality. Whether believers die before the coming of Christ or not, all will be changed. The dead will rise aphartoi, incorruptible, and we will be changed. This corruptible being will be clothed with incorruptibility, and this mortal being will be clothed with immortality. The process of this ontological transformation through the pneuma, however, has already begun, is already beginning in the mortal empirical existence that humans share. They bear both the image of Adam and Christ. It is perfectly legitimate here to read a passage from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, which virtually serves as a commentary on his argument in 1 Corinthians 15. Now the Lord, he says, is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. All of us, gazing with unveiled face on the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory as from the Lord who is Spirit. Now, if we read 1 Corinthians 15 and 2 Corinthians 3 together, we grasp that Paul sees the process of ontological transformation as already at work through the resurrection Spirit that defines the resurrected Jesus as life-giving Spirit. For Paul in 1 Corinthians, however, such ontological change demands also a moral transformation, and there is a connection between the two. Our moral actions have ontological implications, and our ontological condition gives rise to moral possibilities. He speaks of death as the last enemy conquered by resurrection in the end time, but insists that the sting of death is sin. He declares that if the resurrection is not real, they are still in their sins. And he says of those who live as though there was no future resurrection, let us then eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Such people, he says, are self-deceived. Bad company corrupts, pherousin, good morals. He tells them, become sober righteously and stop sinning, for some of you do not know God. 15:34. Such insistence on moral change, to be sure, extends throughout his letter. But 1 Corinthians 15 provides the eschatological, ontological assumptions underlying Paul's moral exhortations and makes of them something much more than mere moralism. Now, where are we? How are you doing? I'd have a lot more time, but the people who introduced me went on and on. So, I have several books here that I want to, we'll try to move through this. All right. That was heavy lifting, I know. Let's turn to the functions of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians. Paul doesn't define pneuma, so we're left to learn its characteristics from the terms he uses in association with it and by the functions he ascribes to it. In his eschatological discourse in chapter 15, we already saw pneuma associated with the incorruptible rather than the corruptible, with the immortal rather than the mortal, with strength rather than weakness, with glory rather than shame, and above all, heard it described as life-giving. Now, when we turn to the other parts of the composition, we see at once that Paul slightly confuses the situation by speaking of pneuma, Spirit, with some frequency, not as an eschatological divine reality, but very much as a present time dimension of human psychology. Thus, Paul can speak of being holy, both in body and spirit, in 7:34, or having his spirit refreshed in 16:18, or of someone's spirit praying when they speak in tongues in 14:14, or of the excommunicated man having his flesh destroyed so that the pneuma might be saved. And when he says that he will come to the community in a spirit of mildness, he refers to human dispositions. Even some of these statements, though, suggest an understanding of spirit that might apply as well to the way he thinks of the Spirit of God. Thus, in 2:11, he speaks of the human spirit in terms of a power of interiority, of introspection. Among human beings, he says, who knows what pertains to a person except the spirit of the person that is within? And in 5:3, he tells his readers that although he is absent in the body, he is present in spirit, suggesting that pneuma, even at the level of human psychology or anthropology, is not confined utterly by space or the individual body. It's able to get outside of the body into other bodies. Indeed, in that same passage, describing a gathering of the Corinthian community in which I am with you in spirit by the power of the Lord Jesus. This is 5:4. Most of the time, however, Paul's language about pneuma refers to the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit from God, even in cases where he omits such specific qualification. And at least three aspects of Paul's usage requires our attention if we are thinking about the ontological implications of resurrection. The first is the way in these chapters he closely associates the pneuma with Jesus. Not the Jesus of human history, but the Jesus who is Kyrios. Most dramatically, Paul makes the Spirit, as we saw, the basis for the confession of Jesus as Lord. Nobody speaking ento pneumati hagio, nobody speaking by the Spirit. Nobody speaking by the Spirit of God says, "Cursed be Jesus." That is, simply sees Jesus as a false Messiah, cursed by God. And nobody is able to say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. En pneumati hagio. Similarly, when speaking of the Corinthians' transition from their former vice to a state of being cleansed, made holy, made righteous in 6:11, Paul combines the instrumentality of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the instrumentality of the Spirit of our God. They go hand in hand. The Spirit of God is thus closely linked to Jesus as Lord. But the Spirit also mediates the presence of Jesus as risen Lord to others. After declaring the intimate unity that results from sexual relations, the one who clings or adheres to a prostitute becomes one body, for it says the two became one flesh, Paul makes this remarkable statement about another form of intense intimacy, quote, and the one who cleaves, adheres to the Lord is one pneuma. We have to supply with him. This is 6:16-17. Note how in this pneumatic unity has somatic implications for believers, a theme I will pursue in the next presentation. For now, I take note of another text pointing to the Spirit as mediator of presence. For by means of one Spirit, we have all been baptized into one body, whether Jews or Hellenes, whether slaves or free, and we have all been made to drink of the one Spirit. Paul sees the Spirit's relation to humans as a form of intimacy or even interiority. The Spirit, Corinthians have received the Spirit that comes from God, 2:12. The Spirit that penetrates the deep things of God the way that a person's own spirit examines the self, so that they can know the gifts given them by God. They are to discern spiritual things, ta pneumatika, spiritually, pneumatikos, because they are spiritual people, pneumatikoi, who have been taught by the Spirit. Didaktois pneumatikos, pneumatos. Or at least, that is the ideal. If they are teleoi, if they are mature. In fact, Paul regards them as immature, as babes, as fleshly and as psychic, because their competitive behavior shows them not to get what the Spirit is about. He needs to remind them repeatedly about the ontological implications of the resurrection. Do you not know that y'all, it's plural, y'all are God's sanctuary, and that the Spirit of God dwells, oike, in or among you? This is something they should know, but they act as though they didn't. So he warns them, if anybody destroys, fere, God's sanctuary, remember that language about corrupting or destroying in chapter 15, God will destroy this one. He tells them again in his discussion of sexual immorality, or do you not know that y'all's body is the sanctuary of the Holy Spirit within or among you, and humin, which you have from God, and you are not your own. Now, let's try to connect a few of these dots. If Paul uses spirit language for the designation of Jesus as Lord and for the intimate presence of Jesus to believers, then we might need to look more closely at the places in this letter and in many others where Paul speaks of Christians as being in Christ, en Cristo, 11 times in 1 Corinthians, and in the Lord, en Kyrio, 9 times in 1 Corinthians. Just, in other words, as he can speak of drinking the one Spirit and of the Spirit dwelling in them, so apparently he can speak of them being in Christ, in the Lord, in the Spirit, in a manner that suggests a sharing or communication at the level of being, rather than simply a spatial referent or a moral influence. The mutual indwelling of the risen Lord Jesus, the Spirit, and the Corinthians, at the very least a mutual influence at the level of energy, power, and presence, seems to be a conclusion demanded by the way in which Paul uses language. Such an impression is not diminished when we turn to the functions that Paul ascribes to the Spirit. Thus, in 1, 5, and 6, he thanks God for the enrichment of the Corinthians in speech and knowledge. He says, just as the witness of Christ was confirmed among you. But in 2, 4, he speaks of the kerygma as accompanied not by convincing words of wisdom, but by the demonstration of the Spirit and power, so that their faith might be based not in the wisdom of humans, but in the power that comes from God. The powerful demonstration of the Spirit, we conclude, is the way that the witness of Christ was confirmed and established among them. Similarly, in 2:10, Paul speaks of the Spirit as the one who has revealed the mysteries otherwise unknowable to humans. Paul and his associates speak with words taught by the Spirit rather than in words taught by human wisdom. The contrast here is not our The contrast here is between mere human capacity and the empowerment given by the Spirit. The observations I have made concerning Paul's discussion of the resurrection in 1 Corinthians 15 and his use of spirit language throughout that composition lead to 5 conclusions and 2 questions. These are very brief. First, the resurrection is for Paul and those who preach as he did more than a historical event of the past concerning Jesus. It is an eschatological reality that affects believers in the present and anticipates the character of their future existence, in which God will be all things in all things. 2, the exalted Lord Jesus is the life-giving Spirit and the source of the Spirit that touches and transforms the Corinthians. The confession that Jesus is Lord and the conviction of being in the Holy Spirit are correlative and mutually defining realities. 3, the Holy Spirit that examines the deep things of God and is the medium of the risen Lord's presence to the Corinthians is also the medium of an intense and mutual indwelling between God and humans. The Corinthians have drunk the one Spirit. The Spirit dwells in them. They are in the Spirit and are in Christ and are in the Lord. The consistent use of such locative prepositions suggests a deep and intersubjective relationship. 4, the presence of the Holy Spirit among and within the Corinthians is the basis for the process of their personal and social transformation. Once sinners, they are now made clean, made holy, made righteous. The Spirit from God has empowered them to know, speak, and perform in ways not available to and not grasped by the merely natural human. 5, The resurrection, therefore, initiates what Paul elsewhere calls a new creation, and indeed a new humanity, based in the last Adam who has become life-giving spirit. Not a forgiveness of sins from the outside is meant here, but an ontological change in the structures of human existence. Such conclusions raise important questions, two of which provide a transition to the next presentation. First, if the endpoint, the telos of the new creation, is a spiritual body, a soma pneumatikon, what are the implications here and now for the understanding and use of the body? How does the ontology of resurrection require a reconsideration of body? How seriously are we to take Paul's calling the Corinthian assembly Christ's body? Second, if we all must be changed, as Paul states, how does the process of moral growth work for the transformation of the individual and social self? Or to put it another way, how can living according to the mind of Christ direct Christ's body to its proper goal, or telos? Thank you for your attention.
And that expresses our deep appreciation for this passionate, informative, and inspiring presentation. And please join us tomorrow morning. In fact, please join us for the discussion, if you are able, in a few minutes. And tomorrow morning for the second lecture on the body in question, the complexities of somatic existence.